Who are they kidding? Life can suck. It's filled with challenges, heartbreak, suffering, and regrets. Life can be cruel, confusing, and unfair. But life is also wonderful, fulfilling, and fun. It's filled with opportunities, exciting new experiences, and a chance to correct mistakes of the past. There is a way out. It will not always be this hard. From the first day we are born, we rely on other people. But people can let us down. Whether they intend to or not, our parents, our siblings, our friends, and those in our community can do things to hurt us. When people hurt, they pass pain along to others. Hurt people hurt people. Broken people break people. These forces shape us. They shape who we will become and where we will go in life. If we're not careful, they will make us become some of the things we hate or destroy our future. None of us asked to be born. When things at home are messed up, we can struggle to find a way to cope and a reason to care. When we're hurt, angry, or lonely, it's tempting to quit trying with an attitude of, "Who cares anyway, and why shouldn't I?" When you feel helpless, insecure, afraid, powerless, ashamed, misunderstood, the temptation is to respond out of fear, anger, and desperation. We all face crises in life. Traumatic and tragic things happen to all of us. The question is, how will we respond to them? Life is what you make of it. More to the point, life is all about how you respond to it. You have the power to make it better or worse, based on how you respond or react to its challenges. It may not feel like it now from where you're sitting, but nothing is more important than your education. Why is education key? When the challenges and problems of your teenage life are pressing in on you, your education gives you a constructive focus while preparing you for success and your future. No one finishes a race if they don't know where they're going. The biggest obstacle to success is losing focus. Focus and future go together. Education is key to your future and success because it keeps you focused toward your future while you navigate and face the distracting challenges of your teenage years. The problems and sufferings can only get worse when we respond in destructive ways. If you think life is harsh now, responding to the problems in your life in self-defeating and destructive ways can take you further than you want to go, keep you longer than you want to stay, and cost you more than you're willing to pay. They can take you down a path from which you can never fully recover. Some choices last a lifetime. Today's student faces challenges, circumstances, and dangers unlike any generation before. Today's student has adult-sized problems, and it often feels impossible to find anyone who understands. We must ring the bell of awareness about these challenges and dangers, and assure students that these forces do not have to destroy their lives. We can overcome through right responses.
I'm inmate number 328754. I'm serving 15 years in prison. I've been here for 5 years because I wanted to mix drugs and weapons with education. While I was in high school, I lettered in 3 sports and had a hidden letter that landed me in prison. During my senior year in high school, I was arrested for armed robbery and lost the opportunity to receive my diploma and graduate with my class. I got caught up in the fast life, money, drugs, guns, cars, and girls that sidetracked me from school and educational achievements. I became obsessed with the fast life. I was driven by peer pressure and older guys in my neighborhood who had all these flashy things, and I wanted to be flashy too. Those were the worst choices of my life, and a first class ticket stamped with a 15-year bid. Now I sit here today contemplating about the choices and decisions I made, wishing I stayed in school and not followed the wrong crowd, wondering about the real man I could become with an education, probably maybe a professional athlete and a family man with a real job.
It would be easy to say that it's not my fault for some people, but I don't put the blame anybody but myself because I didn't have to do what I did. No matter what, there's no excuse for taking another life. There's no excuse for lashing out against anybody in anger. It didn't matter that I felt alone, that it wasn't an excuse to do what I did. I owned up to what I did. You know, I wasn't the type of person that wasn't going to take responsibility for my actions.
As a teenager, I thought it seemed to be all perfect. A loving mom, grandparents, aunts, uncles, cousins, and friends. From a teenager's point of view, I had it all. But it wasn't perfect. It was a lie. At 15, I would learn that my mother was a prostitute. My father was her pimp. I was abandoned by my mother, her pimp, my father, who wanted nothing to do with me. I would never be the same again. I began to strike back on prostitutes and strippers that reminded me of her. This striking back took the form of sexual assault and the rape of these type of women. At this particular point in my life, I cared about nothing. I actually felt like a stranger in my own life.
I'm inmate number 289629, serving a 25-year sentence. As of March 22nd, I've been in prison 10 years. I guess one of my earliest memories from childhood, when I was about four, I remember playing in the house with my aunt, and I remember hearing a loud explosion sort of noise outside. I went outside, that's when I found my dad laying beside his car, covered with blood. My mom screaming, she had shot him twice, and screaming to get help. We went and called an ambulance to come and get him, but at that point, my life became a tale of two different worlds. My mom and dad got divorced. My dad stayed in a hometown, and my mom and I moved on to Charleston, where she remarried to my stepfather. My dad stayed on my life for about three more years. During this time, I readjusted to my stepdad, who was an alcoholic. He was also a cocaine user. And used to like to take me out in the yard every week and give me boxing lessons, telling me if I didn't toughen up, I was gonna be a faggot like my dad when I grew up. He abused my mom, and it was just a terrible environment. It caused me to become real, real introverted. My dad decided to come back into my life when I was about seven. He had remarried, and the woman he married had a son 7 years older than me. So as I'm adjusting to my stepdad, now I'm having to readjust back to my father wanting to come back into my life. And I would go with him during the summer, stay with my mom during the school year. So when I move in there, my brother begins sexually abusing me until I was 11. So I would go home with my mom during the school year and be there with a physically abusive stepfather. Then I would go with my dad in the summer and be there with a sexually abusive stepbrother. I got my mom on one side telling him, don't tell my dad what's going on. I got my stepbrother there threatening me not to tell my dad what's going on. It pulled me apart inside. Like I said, I became real introverted. My outlet was school. School was the only place I could find comfort where nobody knew what was going on. I didn't feel any kind of pressure. I always did real well in school, and I hated going home. The older I got, the deeper I kind of withdrew away from everybody. I was real shy around crowds. And my mom got divorced from my stepdad when I was around 11. Got with another boyfriend. Was an alcoholic, smoked crack. And I had a stepsister, a half-sister this time. And the abuse split from me over to her. And I never helped her. I never once would step in and stop it. And I couldn't come out of my shell. Finally, I had a run in with him when I was about 14. And I finally called my dad and told him I wanted to come and live with him full time. When I called, he wasn't home. I had to call my granddad. I got my granddad there. He took me back. The next day, my dad sat me down, him and my stepmom, told me they were getting a divorce. So the one stable home I'd always had, as far as not having to move, because my mom and I, we would move anytime the rent come up, we pretty much moved. We probably moved 3 or 4 times a year. Was gone.
I'm inmate 265630, serving a 30-year mandatory sentence for murder. I've been incarcerated for 14 years. When I was 3 years old, my mother, my twin brother, and my sister were all killed in an auto accident. And I never knew my real father. And my adoptive family was abusive, physically, mentally. Had a lot of issues that I was dealing with as a young child. Those issues made me rebellious, resentful, because I felt that I was being told to not talk. I was angry because I felt that I had justified feelings that I couldn't articulate as a child. I was rebellious against my parents because I felt like that was the only way that they would understand me, that I could get through to them.
I'm inmate number 338592. I'm serving a 15-year sentence. I've been here 3 years. I'd say the forces that really shaped my life growing up, when I was real little, I had two stepbrothers, and you know, one thing was physical abuse, you know, growing up, mom and dad both, and then stepbrothers came later to live with us. I was probably maybe I was about 4 or 5 years old, and they molested me when I was real little. And coming home every day to arguing, mom and dad constantly arguing, then, you know, being physically abused, and I mean, it was just a nonstop thing till probably I was about 8 or 9 years old, and you know, mom left, come home from school, she was gone. Then realized that how much dad was actually drinking at that point. Dad had always drank, we just never really kind of paid it attention, but it got worse. He stayed drunk. He wasn't really dad, he was just more like the guy who lives with us, who pays the bills.
My name is inmate 293570. It's the number I was given the day I came to the South Carolina Department of Corrections. I was told to memorize it because it was what I'd be answering to. I've been locked up for 11 years now on a sentence of 45 years. Day per day, no good time, no work credits, no parole, no hope. I'm here for the crime of murder in the first degree. When I was a little kid, yeah, I was abused a lot. The earliest memory I have of my family is of my mom and dad fighting, my dad hitting my mom on a regular basis. The most vivid memory I have of my own dad is when I was in the second grade. He came into my room in the middle of the night holding a .357 snub-nosed pistol, and he was waving it around, and he held the gun up to his head, and he told me that he was going to make me watch while he blew his brains out. And, you know, it never really got any better from there with him.
A troubled home environment can have a significant impact on your thinking, attitude, and your overall outlook on life. When our home and family is messed up, we can lose interest in our future and success. Abusive parents and siblings, sexual abuse, drug abuse, hostility and conflict, neglect, absentee parents, and divorce leaves us with a sense of being lost, empty, and alone.
To beat my mom and then come in there and find a reason to beat me. I was so afraid of my dad that when I was in second grade, I actually got molested by his best friend's son, who was a high school senior. He was making me perform sex acts on him in their house. And I was so afraid of my dad that I was afraid that if I told him what his friend's son was doing to me, that he would be angry at me and he would blame me for messing up his friendship with his friend, and that it would somehow be my fault. And so in my mind, it was my fault, you know, and I never told anybody about that. And to this day, you're the first ones hearing about it. Coming up in school, you know, I was always picked on, and it got to a point where my mother, who was really the only person I had in my life, the only person who really didn't treat me like garbage, put me in self-defense classes to learn to fight so I could defend myself, because there wasn't a week that would go by that some bully wouldn't try to beat me up.
I am inmate 294726. I'm here for first-degree burglary and first-degree criminal sexual conduct. My first memory was of me getting beaten and watching my mother getting beaten. These were about an everyday thing for me. I can't remember at what age my uncle and aunt started sexually abusing me. All I remember is that it was a thing that happened for a couple of years, which started me from wetting my bed, which would cause me to get beaten every morning. That's the way I would wake up every morning, is by getting beaten. I thought that all fathers beat their wives and kids. That's the way they show love to their family. I lived in fear. I lived in fear of the man that should have been my father. I can't remember of a single time that my father ever beaten my brothers or sister. One day when I came from school, I remember my mom telling me that Robert had left her, that he wasn't coming back no more, which Robert was my stepfather. I was happy. I was one happy kid. I thought all those fears were all gone. No more being beaten, no more watching my mother getting beaten. I was wrong of that. My mother started beating me. As she beat me, she would let me know why, telling me that it was my fault that Robert had left her, telling me that I was no good, that I'll never amount to nothing. I tried to be a good kid for my mom. I would clean the house for her, cook food for my brothers and sisters so she didn't have to when she got off of work. But it was never good enough for her. So I started living in fear of my mother. For many years I lived in fear of her. Then my mom moved in with this one guy. And he was a nice guy and all, but his brother and sister were something different. They started sexually abusing me too. It was the same old thing all over again, living in fear of people that should be loving me, taking care of me.
I'm inmate number 313778. I got a 20-year sentence. I've been locked up 7 years now. As a child, I felt hopeless, weak, miserable, bound up inside. I was raised by a stepfather from the age of two. Had a lot of issues growing up as far as punishment, being tied up for drunken games, hold her hands up under water to almost drowning point. I was raised up with a brother that was 2 years older than I was, and the problems that we had with a stepfather, with abusive and mental abuse that we went through, it made a bond between us that was strong, because all we wanted from a stepfather was love. So when my stepfather would put his hands on my brother, hitting him in the face, calling him stupid, a bastard, it really got to me, and eventually it started turning to anger. And I realized that I wanted to get rid of the problem. And me and my brother went to a counselor at school one time to tell them about the problems we was going through. But we left before we ever talked, because we were scared of coming home to our stepfather after they would call home or mention the facts that we went into the counselor's office.
I'm inmate 155352, and it only took a second to commit the crime of murder once I decided to do it. I'm 41 years old, and I can serve 24 years on a life sentence for taking my mom's life when I was 17, back in 1988. My story begins when I was 6 years old, when my older brother tried to molest me out at the hay barn on our family farm. Then 6 months later, he shot me in the left arm with a 12-gauge shotgun, nearly killing me and maiming me for the rest of my life. These events and fighting in school over the years, over racial issues, being blamed for slavery hundreds of years before I was born, culminated in me having hate and anger in my heart and mind, which led me to take my mom's life, during a fit of rage and anger during an argument. It's never wise to hold things back, not to tell when those are abusing you, from bullying, etc. Always tell, I've lost my family, I've lost my mother, I've also lost my freedom, because I'll probably never get out of jail. I'll probably die of old age here. It's been a long 20 years. I really miss my family, and I miss my mom. It's been hard.
I'm inmate number 270085. I'm serving 999 years in prison. I've been here for a little over 11 years. Life is filled with choices, some good, some bad, and every choice has a consequence. But never could I have dreamed that having an extramarital affair would have had the consequence of coming to prison. I used to tell my children all the time, it's okay to make mistakes, just don't make the same ones over and over again. I should have listened to my own advice. When I was young, I liked seeing what I could get away with, being sneaky. Not harmless things, but things I shouldn't have been doing, nevertheless. I never felt truly loved while I was growing up. And because of that, my acting out, my trying to be sneaky, in some sense, I was seeking attention. In the back of my mind, hoping to get caught, because that way I would get attention. But arguing with my father and getting in trouble became a daily routine. I was the black sheep of the family. At least that's how I saw myself. Because of actions, because of words, that's how I perceived myself. And perception is everything. I spent my entire youth viewing my dad as someone who enjoyed punishing me and my brother. I viewed my mom as someone who loved us, but just always came in too late. She tried to play the savior role, but it was too late. Afterwards, after the beatings, I mean, it didn't do any good to get comfort then, you know. I looked at it as if, where were you 10 minutes ago? Because of that, I had a distorted view of what true love and true happiness was supposed to be.
Life sentence without the prospect of parole has gone into my 20th year of incarceration. Back as far as I can remember, 8 or 9 years old, seeing pornography up under the mattress of my father. I think it was X-rated magazine. It kind of early on shaped my thinking in terms of promiscuity. Perverted, looking at women. I was curious what was going on in the bedrooms with my father and my mother. Coming home from school, one of the things that really traumatized me, I think it was around 14 years old when mama and dad separated, and I wanted to know what went on, and she just said they separated. I couldn't really get the straight of what was going on, so I did research, and it was said that my father had advanced my sister in some way. It blew my mind. It rocked my world. I wasn't ready for that. I couldn't process what happened between my mom and my father. It shaped my thinking, my views about parents, right and wrong. I basically let go of my strength. I was told to do what they said to do, not what I thought I should do. Pretty much went in a downward spiral in terms of respect for authority. I didn't think parents knew what they were talking about. I didn't think grown-ups were right because I saw them say do one thing and do something else. I went through a lot of emotional confusion. As a teenager, I just couldn't find my place in society. I really was confused about what right and wrong was until I got in my teens, because, you know, you get shaped as a child, your thinking gets shaped as a child. Parents don't really know what they're doing when they let their child see them do one thing and say something else. Got out in the streets and the clubs, a lot of robbing, shooting, in terms of trying to adjust to a normal life, which I never really had. I never knew what it was. Lost respect for my mom. Men were in and out of my home. I thought that no man should touch my mama but my father. It hurt me. I wanted to kill them.
I'm inmate number 300882. I'm serving a 27-year sentence for armed robbery, assault, battery, intent to kill, distribution of cocaine. I've been in prison for 6.5 years. I was born and raised in Chicago, Illinois. I grew up to a good family. What I thought, I found out my father was a drug dealer involved in gang life. My mother was an alcoholic that worked third shift. I was the baby of three children.
My dad didn't want to live in the home with my stepmom. My stepmom didn't want to live in the home with my dad, so they left. So I was essentially parentless for going on 2 years, staying with my stepbrother. This is the time I started high school. When I got into high school, things began to change. I started to come out of my shell more. Without my parents around, I started to develop this real arrogant, egotistical sort of persona of I'm going to do whatever I want to do, when I want to do it, and how I want to do it, because nobody gives a crap about what I'm doing anyway. And at this time, I met some guys who were selling marijuana. Got hooked up with them and started getting a little business going, moved on to selling some cocaine. Started to become a little more outgoing in school. Still doing real well in school, taking AP classes, staying straight on that, straight A's. But I began to be the big guy, everybody's friend. Everybody knew me, and I loved it. The more people knew me, the more power I felt I had. The more I loved it, the bigger my head got. I started committing a lot of crimes around this time, as far as damaging property. I got caught about 8 times for possession of drugs. Each time, because my family knew the police and things around the area, I always got out of it. And all this did was fuel my ego. I felt like there was nothing I was incapable of as far as committing a crime or anything in my life. My granddad had always told me there's nothing I couldn't do, and I started to use that in a criminal mindset. And there was nothing I thought I couldn't get away with. So all through high school, I just got more and more outgoing. My head got bigger, and I started to really develop this thought pattern of I can't be caught, I'm above the law. So graduated high school thinking I had the world in my palm, could do whatever I wanted, when I wanted. Didn't really have any parents to tell me I couldn't.
I wanted a relationship with my adopted father, but he was always working. I got to see him on the weekends for the most part. It was just real difficult being alone all the time and wanting a relationship with family that I knew I was gonna never have, at least that's what it seemed like to me. Because my father wasn't around, I began to resent him and rebel against him. I began using drugs, alcohol. It got to a point in my life where I no longer respected their authority, and I refused to listen to anything that they said.
We can experience fear, insecurity, and anger as a result of emotional detachment from our parents or dysfunctional home life. These feelings can cause us to act out in reckless and destructive ways. Responses such as physical aggression, withdrawal, and rebellion can push us to the edge and cause us to lose our way.
My father got to an altercation because he wanted to discipline me. We got to physical altercation, picked up the phone to call the police, and I took off, took a few belongings, put it in a backpack, and left. That's when my life in the streets, I say, began. I was homeless probably for close to a year, sleeping in abandoned trailers, empty houses, shoplifting, stealing just to get by. Met individuals on the street that introduced me into a gang culture where part of my initiation was to beat a total stranger, an innocent bystander, just for no apparent reason at all. When I reached out to people and needed help to get out the trouble I was in. There was no one there. And again, I felt alone, started selling drugs. To me, it was exciting at the time. I had plenty of money. I bought jewelry, cars, clothes. I thought that I was going to be satisfied having all these material things that I've never had before. What I really needed was a family.
I never could, you know, seek a coping, anything to cope with, or I didn't know a way to cope. It just seemed like everything was closing in on me, and I was just trying to have to suck it all up and deal with it. Just bottle it all up and stuff it away and act like everything's okay. I never really got into a whole lot of trouble when I was young. I tried to be above that. I tried to live above that, and tried going to the military. That didn't work out. I was just too caught up in my own mind that all those things were slowly catching up to me. It was hard to deal with. Not until I was, I guess, about 18 or so. This was after I'd failed in the military, and I'd come back, and I started heavy drug abuse, drinking. I was going down that same path that I didn't want to go down. I started going down this same the very same path that my dad. I said I'd never be my dad, and I started drinking. I started abusing all the drugs and everything like that, trying to cope with everything that was inside.
You know, I was never socially accepted growing up. School was never fun. I was that kid that sat in the corner of the cafeteria and could clear a whole table just by sitting down. I was that one lonely kid that nobody, even the uncool kids, didn't want to be seen sitting with me because they were afraid to bring them down the food chain. That never changed from the time I was in first grade all the way up until I was in high school.
I started acting out, running away from home, going crazy, just doing stupid things. I can remember the first time I ran away. I wrote a letter, gave to my brother to give to my mom. And with that, I was gone. I didn't get too far before the cops found me. I was in the middle of a field with a knife in my throat. I was tired of all the pain, all the abuse, the sexual abuse, the physical abuse, the mental abuse. I was tired of all of it, so I was going to make it stop myself. And the way about making it stop is by killing myself. That was my first cry for help. But nobody can hear my cries. I wanted to tell the cops everything that was happening. The sexual abuse, the physical abuse. I wanted to tell them everything, but I was scared to tell them. I feared letting them know what was happening to me. But I also feared going home to my mom. And I also feared killing myself. So fear won over and I went home to my mom. I lost a lot because of that. I lost my ability to show love. I lost my ability to care about people. I lost my ability to ask people for help. Scared to ask people for help. Letting them know that I'm scared of something. All because I lived in fear. A fear of being a nobody. And with that, rage took over. And I just didn't care what happened to me or anybody else.
My rebellion started against my parents when I was about 6 or 7 years old because of the things I went through with my stepfather raised me. All I wanted was love from my stepfather, and it was lacked from my stepfather. So the authority figure doing these things to me, I had a lot of rebelled against any kind of authority. Teachers in school, trying to tell me what to do, I rebelled against them. When I started driving, I had a problem with authority giving me driving tickets. I never paid any tickets. The problems I had with my stepfather led to drug use at a young age. And the drug use I started got me with coping mechanisms to escape reality, to help me from living in the reality I was living in, because I was scared to come home to a stepfather that was abusive mentally and physically. Their drug use got real bad, every drug possible. We had a lot of bitterness towards him when we started getting older, because a lot of the fear turned to anger. Going to high school, I started playing football for a big high school, started going to ROTC programs, started welding class for my future. All my future failed when I got caught in class with dope. That caused me to not want to try as much, stop caring as much, started rebelling against my teachers because of my suspension from school. I had quit school in 10th grade and moved in with my real father in North Carolina, started back school, and a lot of the problems had already been caused through my childhood, so trying to fix them in the drug use, and I never was able to have a girlfriend coming up, so when I had the freedom of living my real dad, I really didn't know how to handle the situations. I was never able to make my own choices, go out when I wanted to, and it caused me to run wild. And I got locked up at the age of 16 for trying to steal cars to go see a girlfriend. Because when I did have girlfriends, I felt so deep attached to them because of the love lack and not be able to have that affection when I was a child. On up to when I was about 15 years old. That's when I ran away. I got out of prison when I was 17. Come live back in South Carolina with my mom. Got a job, got my own place, started doing good. But I was still using drugs, and when I had extra money, it caused the drug problems to get even worse because I had more money to spend on drugs. It had got to the point where that's all I cared about, getting high, partying, police staying at my house, rebelling against my neighbors, telling them to mind their own business. Everybody started hating me because of my drug use and the actions that was caused on my drugs.
In my teens, I confused physical pleasure with love. Once I became sexually active, in my mind, that's what I thought love was. It made me feel good. I was making the female feel good. And that was how distorted my mind was. That's what I considered true love and true happiness, physical pleasure. I needed attention, and it seemed that that was a good way to get it.
I learned the drug life at a young age. Started smoking weed young, running the streets, hanging with the gangs. Before I even learned how to ride a bike, I learned how to shoot a gun. By the time I was 12, my grandmother figured it was time for me to move, so I moved to South Carolina, not knowing that my father had left my mother, abused my mother. So I started going to school in South Carolina, still hanging with the wrong crowd. But you know, my grandmother preached to me, she always wanted me to finish school. Luckily, thankfully, I did finish school. But I also had a child at a young age, so I had a decision I had to make. So I chose to go to the United States Army after I served 5 years, got honorable discharge, came back to civilian life. Thought I was gonna prosper.
My thinking got so far out there that when I got about 20 years old, I had started to get so hooked on drugs that my thinking was so messed up that I had got to the point where I had a child this time. I drank my own child's medicine one time because I was so wanting to get high. I'd got so far ingrained in drug culture, using drugs, selling drugs, that my mind just didn't function right. So in 2002, I was going to get some cocaine from a guy, and I told myself on the way that I was going to rob him. And I told myself I might have to kill him. And I really thought that I could get away with it. So I got to where I was going, met up with him. He came to my car, I pulled out my pistol, shot him 4 times, and drove off. And had no remorse for it at the time. Didn't think I was gonna get caught. Didn't care, really. Because I let my thinking get so far out that I thought I could do whatever I wanted, that I was above the law and I had to answer to no one.
I had a son. He was just a baby, and I'm in the streets, carrying pistols, trafficking drugs, using drugs, endangering him and his mother. Then it got to a point in my life where I guess I wanted more excitement. And I went from selling drugs to armed robberies. No real reason. I was angry. Had no respect for authority. All these different things in my life, I just seemed that I couldn't stop. Not long after that, I had another child, had a daughter. Now I have a daughter, a son in the world. Destroying my life, destroying their life by the decisions that I was making. Now, because of those decisions, both my son and my daughter without their father.
I tried to let all the drinking and everything go, and tried to let all that stuff go, just, but I had no way of coping. And there was this one instance where I thought, this is what led it, when I'd committed the crime that I had committed, I thought, maybe I can get away with it. Everybody else does. I'm a sex offender. And it's a label that I'll have to wear for the rest of my life. There's no erasing it. Even when I do get out of here in the, next 10 years, I'll have to wear that forever. I'll be labeled. I deserve it.
And the hurt continued to grow. I continued to bottle it up. I didn't express it to anybody. I smiled and endured because I didn't know what else to do. And finally, one day, I had smiled and endured as long as I possibly could. And one day it was just a perfect storm. And the wrong things were said at just the wrong time and just the wrong place. And I lashed out. Literally every single thing, every single bit of pain that I'd ever felt in my entire life got unloaded onto that one person. And that ended up taking her life. And she didn't deserve that. She was just fixing to turn 18 years old. I was only 18 myself. She had her whole life ahead of her, and so did I. I ended her life, and I ended my own while I was at it. I just hadn't realized it yet.
All that rage that I had in me, when somebody disrespected me, showed me any kind of disrespect, I would go to them and basically hurt them in any way, physical, shape, or fashion. I broke into a house and sexually abused a young girl, all because I felt disrespected. I had to show people that I had to make people live in fear of me so I would feel better about myself.
I committed a kidnapping because of my drug use got so bad. I got tired of living the life I was. I had nothing. I had no money after I got paid. I felt miserable all the time. I got so sick and tired of my life on the drug use. I had plotted to steal a car from a gas station, but never wound up stealing a car from the gas station. Walking down the road, wound up in somebody's house, kidnapping them. So now I done victimized somebody else because of my miserable life. I included them in something that shouldn't have never happened. I had a girlfriend that was a co-defendant that got caught up in the situation with me, so I destroyed her life too.
Emotional baggage carried from the past influences us through our lives. In our attempts to flee from our wounded past, we tend to make bad choices. Rather than resolve the hurt and problems of our past, these reckless choices can become the source of more pain and confusion. Often, these choices, like teen pregnancy, dropping out of school, drug and alcohol use, criminal and at-risk behavior, can never be undone.
It took me just a second to commit a kidnapping after I made the decision to do it, but now it's taken a lifetime to outlive the consequences. I will always be labeled as a kidnapper. Even when I get released out of prison, trying to get a job, I will be labeled as a kidnapper. So living through this mistakes is a lifetime. I've lost living with family, lost a daughter through this. I've lost growing through my 20s, 30s with my family because of prison. But I'm not ashamed of losing the friends that I had. That was helping me get high, that encouraged getting high too.
Being sneaky, my search for true love and true happiness, my lust for women, all of that carried over into adulthood. And I ended up having an affair. I had an affair with a coworker, and I never escaped from the affair. Those things were the foundations of what led me to come to prison. I was in jail for 2 weeks. I got out on bond because I'd never been in trouble with the law before, but I quickly realized I'd lost everything. My wife, my kids, my home, my car, my job, my reputation, everything. Everything was gone. Because I was somewhere I shouldn't have been, because I was with someone I shouldn't have been with, because I was doing things I shouldn't have been doing, because of my past, because of my sneakiness, because of my lust for women, all that gave the perception that I was someone who did the wrong thing and enjoyed it. And perception is everything. My parents were the ones who bonded me out. And I finally saw the unconditional love from them that I'd been searching for my whole life. And I also realized that it was always there. They always had it for me. But I was just too stupid, too blind, but most of all, too selfish to have seen it back then. It's been 12 years since I was arrested. And I have not found one humorous thing in prison. I laugh a lot to hide the pain of being here. But I have learned that true love and true happiness doesn't come from a physical act. It comes from the non-tangible evidence that you made a difference in someone's life, that someone's made a difference in your life. It's not how you touch their body, it's how you touch their heart.
Once again, I let the streets take over me. Got fed up, got involved with drugs again. Also started selling drugs, carrying guns, being involved with the wrong crowd. One split second, that's all it took for me to nearly take a man's life. Ended up in prison.
But I learned my lesson when I came to prison. Because I'm serving a 25-year sentence. I got to do 21 years and 3 months on that. I didn't lose my freedom when I came to prison.
What I lost was my opportunity to be a father. I don't have one child, now I have two. I don't see either one of them. I lost my opportunity to be a son to my mother who needs me. I lost my opportunity to be a brother to my sister who's always needed me to be there. I lost time in my life that I'm never gonna get back. All because I thought that I could do what I wanted to do. And that's what I think is my problem, is my criminal thinking made me believe I was untouchable. Now I'm paying the price.
All the things that has happened in my life, I regret time lost with my family, my children. I have a son now who was gotten in trouble with the law. A daughter who's without her father. And it really hurts knowing that the things that they're going through, possibly that I could have prevented or helped with, but somehow I'm to blame because of my decision, because of my choices and my actions. And I've learned that it only takes 1 second to get in this kind of trouble, what it takes a lifetime to deal with the consequences of your actions.
I wasn't there at home to see my oldest daughter excel in her medical career. I wasn't at home to see my son play drums or wrestle in high school. I wasn't at home to give my youngest daughter away at her wedding. I have lost a lot by being selfish.
I'm here for the crime of murder in the first degree. It only took one moment to do the crime that got me to where I am today. But the backlash from that crime is going to last for a lifetime.
And it caused me to lose all my family, being back here, growing with my family through pen and paper, on the phone, instead of being with my family, sitting down with them at a table, eating like a normal family does. It caused me to lose my daughter, her mama, lost more of my childhood because I've been locked up since I've been a teenager. Growing up inside of prison has led me to other issues.
Probably the thing I regret the most is being stripped away from my family, what you go through in prison, incarceration. The food is terrible. You eat when you're told to eat, you shower when you're told to shower, you wear what you're told to wear. It's basically a nightmare. My deepest regret is not being there for my kids, my two daughters who are now grown, losing the relationship with my family, being incarcerated for so long, you kind of lose touch with society, you lose touch with reality. A lot of homosexuality is going on in here, a lot of perversion. It's real sadistic and twisted. You're subject to see anything, stabbing and murders, some rapes that went on at certain times. You pretty much expect anything to happen in here almost at any time. Me going into my 21st year of being incarcerated, I think it's about the worst thing that you can really go through.
Think about all the things that I've lost in those years. I lost a grandmother who passed away. I missed a sister's wedding. I missed my baby nephew being born. I missed my children growing up, going to school, being involved in science, football, basketball. Missed my dad. Now knowing that the things that he did try to teach me, my mother suffered a stroke. It's all those little split seconds, just one little split second, I thought that I was doing something right. Now all of a sudden, now I'm stuck. And it's gonna take me for eternity to get over this.
I'll live with consequences. I'll live with it forever.
Life's demands, cause they chip and they nag and they pull at me, and every little thing I make up my mind to be, like I'ma be a daddy who's in the mix, and I'ma be a husband who stays legit, and I pray that I'm an artist who rises above the road that is wide and filled with self-love. Everything that I see draws me, though it's only in you that I can truly see that it's a feast full of eyes, a low blow to purpose, and I'm a little kid at a three-ring circus. Flashes, say they think that it's you, but they don't know that who you are is not what you do. True, we get it twisted when we peek at the charts. Yo, before we part from the start, where's your heart?
You a pimp?
Hustler, tell me what's your title? America has no more stars, now we call them idols. You said idol, while we teach prosperity, the first thing to prosper should be inside me.